stand and join with us as we begin worshiping together.
Come and stand before your Maker, full of wonder, full of fear. Come behold His power and glory, yet with confidence draw near.
Together and spend time in God's word and spending time with one another growing. Let's continue singing together. Through your Holy Spirit.
Please be seated. I believe in the name of Jesus, and I hope you do as well. Friends, we come here today to obviously worship Jesus, look to Him. We come here to sing praises to Him. We come here to honour Him. And it's wonderful that we can join together as a church. Today we have something special. Today we have Paul Beeston from Compassion coming along and preaching later on, but also giving us some more information about what the work of Compassion does around the world. So let me pray for us now, and we'll hear more from Paul really soon. Father God, we just want to thank you so much for who you are. We want to thank you that you are a God of love and a God of compassion. Father God, we thank you that you are a God that has sent your Son into the world to save people from all nations, old, middle-aged, young adult, youth, little child. You love them all, and you show compassion through your Son Jesus to them all. Father God, we pray today as we come and think about the work of compassion. May you open our hearts and minds to what people in this organization are doing around the world. And Lord, help us that we can also be involved in this work. We just thank you so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'll invite Paul up now.
Morning, Mark.
Morning, Paul. It's wonderful that you can be here.
Thank you.
And I just before you start your presentation, where have you travelled from this morning?
We live a bit up the road at Terrigal on the Central Coast. But with all the freeway stuff, it's only just over an hour, so it was pretty good.
Fantastic.
Yep,
fantastic. And so how long have you been involved in Compassion?
13 years.
Yeah, so fantastic.
Yeah, we love it.
Awesome, yeah. Awesome. Well, I'll let you do what you need to do.
Okay, well, and, thank you. Yeah. Thanks, Mark. It's great to be here with you and nice to meet you all. I'm married to Angela. We have two kids. My son's 17 and my daughter's 14. And as Mark asked, we live on the coast, but we grew up in Sydney, which we love. When I finished Bible college, Mark and I were there at the same time. I went to Nowra and was an assistant minister down there in a church. And so did like what Mark does, get to teach Jesus. And one of the congregation members came up to me one day and he realized that I didn't sponsor a child through Compassion. And he said, "Why don't you sponsor with Compassion?" And I said to him, "I don't know what you're talking about. I've never heard of them. Who are they? Tell me a bit about them." And so there's a slide I think I'll cover in a sec. And there's three things about Compassion, and my friend told me his name's Kristen. And the first one is, I think it's the next slide after that. And one more, sorry guys, about the order. These are the three things my friend said. He said, look, first one, reason I love Compassion is they're Christ-centered. They're all about making Jesus known around the world and helping kids and families come to know Jesus. And I said, oh, that sounds awesome. Okay, that's good to know about Compassion. I love that. Second thing he says that we're compassionate child focused. They want kids who live in poverty, you know, really hard situations around the world, to be loved, to be cared for, to have the opportunities we have in Australia for good health, for Bible teaching, all those things, and to love and care for kids. And my wife and I love kids. She's a teacher. We've always been, you know, had a heart for kids ministry. And so we're like, that sounds great. Two things. And then the third thing he said, Compassionate church-based, so they only work in local churches. So we work in 25 countries around the world. Probably, if you come to the table later, you can see some of the countries we work in. And I said, that sounds unreal, because it's the local church doing what God's called us to, right? Go out and be witnesses to the world. And so I very quickly did nothing about it. until I was in a caravan park visiting a friend, and then the manager had a little profile of a sponsored child up like that, and I said, tell us about that. And he said, yeah, this is one of the sponsor kids. Would you like to sponsor one? So we started sponsoring in a caravan park on the South Coast. And then years later now, I get to work for Compassion and do what he did, which is share about compassion with other people. So I think the next slide, you get to see one of our sponsor children. So one of the things, if you ever get the opportunity, you can actually go and visit your sponsor kids. And for me, that was Trisha. We got to meet Trisha. She was in the Philippines. Now, Trisha's house, do you guys know what your houses are made out of, kids? Yeah, what? Any ideas? Bricks? Yeah. Cladding. Yeah, cladding. Yeah, all that sort of stuff. Well, I went to meet Trisha, and that's Trisha Angeline, her big brother Angelo, her big sister Angelica. My wife's name is Angela, and so it was very confusing. But and then William is dad. And William was showing me his home, and Trisha is leaning on the front door. So that's their front door. It's made out of a mattress in a spring. So you know in your mattresses it's got the springs? That's her front door, and all the walls are made out of inner springs of mattresses that William tied together that he got out of the tip and covered them with blankets and made a home and put a piece of tin over the top. And so that was their home. It was very, very amazing to see his ingenuity, but also very difficult because when a storm comes, it's not a very safe house to be in. And as I got to know them and meet their family, one of the things that it was really exciting to see is that how delighted they are that Trisha could be part of the Compassion program, and they were very thankful. So if you ever get to meet your sponsor kids and their families, they would tell you this in person. But if not, know that it's such a blessing to their family to know that Trisha and your sponsor kids are going to have the opportunity to grow up and be loved and cared for and have opportunities that William never had. His job is looking for scrap metal and stuff like that out of the rubbish tip. Trisha's going to have so many more opportunities because she's sponsored, she comes to the church-run program, she's loved and cared for by Christians who share Jesus with her, but she also has tutoring, she has medical care whenever she needs to, she has regular checkups, she has schooling that helps her, so she goes to a normal school, but also tutoring after school at Compassion to help her be able to get a job, God willing, when she's older, that she can care for her own family and she doesn't have to do a job like Dad, which is looking through garbage. And so thank you for those of you who already sponsor. We're really stoked to have you sponsor. And if you don't sponsor yet and you'd love to, there's many children's profiles up on the table today. Quite a lot of them are from one region of the Philippines, but we've also got kids from other countries as well. So we'd love you to consider sponsoring. And it's easy to do that. You just scan the QR code and fill it in on your phone while you're there. And that's $48 a month, and we'd love you to consider doing that afterwards. But I wanted to introduce you to one more person. This is Eunice, and I got to meet her when I was in the Philippines on that trip. And just this is the impact that sponsorship has had on her family. So let's check that out. And this is Laika. She's one of the kids who are sponsoring. She's 5. She lives in a family with 3 kids, single mom, and one of her jobs is caring for animals. So you might like to sponsor Laika or one of the other kids, but let's meet Eunice now.
We moved to this place after my father lost his job. I live here with my family, my mom and dad, and all my brothers. I am the only daughter. Our home is built over a very dirty river, and when the storms happen, our home floods with water and garbage. This is a scary place when it gets dark. People get drunk and fight all the time.
Ang sponsor ko po si Arlie and Nancy.
Even though I live in this place, I have been sponsored by Arlie and Nancy. I call them Mom and Dad.
Mom and Dad.
Although we are countries apart, I know they chose me. They tell me, Eunice, we remember you. We love you. You are like our own daughter. Because of my sponsors, I had the opportunity to go to the Compassion program at the church in my neighborhood. For all these years, my sponsors and my church have helped me to receive better food and medicine. With the help of my sponsors, I will be able to work to help my own family. When I was 9, My compassion teacher shared Jesus with us. And that's when I accepted Christ. Even though I am poor, He has provided my church. He gave me sponsors who love me. God will never leave us. I want to share everything I have learned with kids who are like me. I want them to feel the joy of having a sponsor, to get a letter that says, "I love you." I want to serve the Lord, and I won't stop serving Him because He does not stop loving me.
There are children around the world waiting for a sponsor like you. Release a child from poverty in Jesus' name.
So that's Eunice. She's amazing. If you would like to sponsor, come see me afterwards, or maybe add an extra sponsor child to your family sponsors already. And as we have saw in the video, you can write your letter to your sponsor child. And I brought the Polaroid cameras as well, so we can take your photo and send it over to them, and you'll be the best sponsor ever. So come and see me afterwards. That'd be great.
Thank you for that, Paul. Yeah, Rachel and I have sponsored children all throughout, and it's actually really, really wonderful to do that. So may I lay that on your hearts. But for now, I'm going to pray, and then something's going to happen, which I think the kids will be more excited about. Father God, we just want to thank you so much for the work of compassion, and we are so thankful that we can partake in that work. Father God, we thank you for those children that are being sponsored. And Lord, we thank you for our own children in this church. We thank you so much that they have the opportunities that others don't have around the world. I have the opportunities now to go and hear about Jesus in comfort with their friends. And Lord, we just thank you so much for the teachers. And Lord, we just pray today would be a wonderful blessing to the children as they go to their kids' church programs. And we just thank you so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, so if you're in primary school, you are in Jungle. There's Christine at the door. There'll be other leaders joining her soon. If you are 18 months to 5 years, you are in Explorers. And if you're younger than 18 months, then you're obviously with a parent. And we have a parent's room, which is located in the Demountable, just closest to this building. And if you remain in the room, well, please introduce yourself to the person next to you.
Good morning, brothers and sisters and friends. It's great to hear your conversations, but let's join together again and pray to our Heavenly Father together. So would you please pray with me? Kind and loving Father, we praise you for your love for us, especially that you have shown us through the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, your Son died on the cross for us. Though we were once far away, you brought us near. For this we praise you. You have done this because of your great love for us, your endless kindness and compassion and mercy. Father, as you have saved us and adopted us into your family, so we ask that you would help us bear the family likeness. Mold us more and more into the image of Christ as we hear your word and are guided to follow and obey it by your Spirit. May we have the same heart for those who are far away from you, those who do not know your Son as Savior and Lord that you have. As you have loved us and saved us, may we be like you and love others such that they would see your glory and know your Son. We praise you that you are already growing your love among us by your Spirit. We praise you that your love is expressed here in our church through the many people who lead as your Son, our King, the servant King, led. We praise you that in his likeness many here serve as well. What a joy it is, Father, that so many in this church serve and lead in so many ways. To your glory, we are led as many people set up chairs, operate technology, serve morning tea and coffee, welcome others, say hello to each other, and do many other things as well. Father, please strengthen all those who lead our church through service. Remind us all again of the glory that it is to be part of your church, to be the bride and body of Jesus Christ who shed his blood for us, so that we would not grow tired of serving, and that we would grow in love for one another and serve all the stronger. Father, you have established governments and you rule all nations. With our upcoming elections, we ask that you would help us all consider, with all wisdom and understanding, how we might best cast our vote. And we ask that you would guide and protect whoever it is that you have chosen to be our local government. Protect them from evil and corruption and the temptations of sin and the evil one. May they govern justly and with all integrity so that we might be able to live peaceable lives and continue in the great mission you have given us in your Son, to make disciples of all nations and to teach them to obey everything he has commanded. And as we pray for the nations, we thank you that you have given us a relative safety and prosperity of living here in Australia. We know that most people in the world do not live with the comforts and luxuries that we do. May we not take them for granted, but always be thankful to you for what we have. But as we consider those who do not have, guide us to think of them with all compassion, as you yourself do. Father, the greatest need anyone has in this world is to be reconciled to you through your Son, our Saviour. But while we endure in this world, there are so many people who face challenges with daily living. You teach us to pray, give us today our daily bread, and we rely on you for all things. You are trustworthy and good and give all good things. And so help us to be generous with what we have, to reach out to those in need in this world, to see to their physical needs. But as we do this, help us to keep the big picture of your plan for this world in mind. May we never forget that it is the salvation you offer through your Son that everyone needs, and that this is the greatest need. And as you help us care for the physical needs of others, may we also speak of your Son and how he meets our greatest need. May we always speak of his love and share his love for all. And may we be made more and more like him every day, that we might love as he loves. Hear us, we pray, in the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Morning, church. Our reading from today is from Luke chapter 5, from verse 17 to 26. Luke 5, 17 to 26. I read. One day, Jesus was teaching, and Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting there. They had come from every village of Galilee and from Judea and Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was with Jesus to heal the sick. Some men came carrying a paralyzed man on a mat and tried to take him into the house to lay him before Jesus. When they could not find a way to do this because of the crowd, they went up on the roof and lowered him on his mat through the tiles into the middle of the crowd, right in front of Jesus. When Jesus saw their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." The Pharisees and the teachers of the law began thinking to themselves, "Who is this fellow who speaks blasphemy? Who can forgive sins but God alone?" Jesus knew what they were thinking and asked, Why are you thinking these things in your heart? Which is easier, to say your sins are forgiven or to say, get up and walk? But I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. So he said to the paralyzed man, I tell you, get up, take your mat and go home. Immediately he stood up in front of them, took what he had been lying on, and went home praising God. Everyone was amazed and gave praise to God. They were filled with awe and said, we have seen remarkable things today. And that's our reading.
Thanks, Sam. Let's pray as we spend some time in God's Word. Lord, it is a real privilege to be here this morning, to meet together, to hear from you directly through your Word, the Bible. We pray that your Spirit will be lifting our eyes to Jesus, to be shaping us, to be molding us, to be more like him. And Father, we just pray we'll be encouraged by your word today and go out and live lives which bring great joy to you as we serve you faithfully and proclaim the name of Jesus. And we pray it in his name now. Amen. Well, I had the privilege, have you, some of you guys heard of Colin Buchanan? He's like, yeah, a Christian entertainer for kids particularly, and he's on the radio and stuff like that. We went to the Philippines together, and we met this family that you're going to see. His name's Dave, and this is the family we met in the Philippines, and that was part of the trip I was telling you about before. I actually have been to other countries other than the Philippines, but for some reason all my stories about Philippines. So this is Dave in the middle with the singlet, the taller child, and there's one other kid in the family who wasn't there the day we got to meet Dave. So Dave's sponsored through Compassion, and this is where they live in their community. So that's their, it's not a house, is it? It's like a piece of rope with a piece of material over it, and that's where they live. So when we were chatting to Dave and the family, they were saying that their house collapsed and caught fire in an earthquake, and they showed us around the corner. And a lot of the houses in the community there are sort of like sheds in our that we would have in our backyard, about the same size, sometimes two stories, mainly made out of timber and bamboo. And anyway, collapsed, caught fire, and burnt to the ground. And so they had nowhere to live, and they couldn't afford the money to rebuild it. So the community let them live on the basketball court, and so they would sleep on the basketball court at night, and that was their setup there. Now, you can't fit all the kids under the tarp, so some of them would just sleep out on the ground, and it was pretty full on. I can't imagine, my son's 17, I don't know what it would be like. He struggles to study as it is. Imagine trying to get an education, all those sorts of things with a situation like that. Anyway, talking to mum, she was saying that she works every day. She makes these little sweetbread loaf things and makes a huge batch of them. And then if she can sell them all in the community, she'll make about $2 or $3 profit. And I was like, oh, that's incredible. Like, it's super hard work. She works really hard and not at all lazy or anything like that. And while we're at this basketball court, it was about the size of this room, there was a bank of doors at the back with padlocks on them. And it's outside. I'm like, what's with the doors with the padlocks? And they said, oh, they're toilets. I was like, okay, that's fair enough, because there's no toilets inside the homes, no running water or anything like we have. And they don't have a house. So, yeah, they explained to me that to use the toilet, they have to pay about 2 pesos per visit to the bathroom. And so I'm crunching the numbers with the amount of kids in the family and all that sort of stuff. And then so it worked out roughly about 50 cents a day to use these privately owned toilets. And so for $2 or $3 that mum gets, she has to spend that much just on sending the kids to use the facilities. And I was like, that's incredible. She's not thinking through tutoring, swimming lessons, learning another language, insurance for the house or superannuation, all those things that we have. She's just thinking, how do I give my kids the bare necessities, be able to use the bathrooms, provide for food and medical care and all that sort of stuff. And that was, for me, a real eye-opener to how hard life is for kids and families living in poverty. And then I come back to Australia and driving on the roads, which just feels like you're on a cloud. It's like so lovely and everything's clean and it's just amazing. It's amazing how Australia, how great it is in Australia. And but the challenge was, what do I do as a Christian man and Christian family come back home? You're faced with the reality, short plane ride, right, that families live in situations like that. And how? What would God have us do? And so that's what we're doing this morning. We're looking at God's Word, reading the Bible, thinking, what would God have us do when we hear about situations and reality of situations like that? So let's spend some time doing that in His Word. So first of all, I had a guy come up to me very early on when I started with Compassion, and he said, "But what do you think the root cause of poverty is?" I thought, that's a really good question, isn't it? What's the root cause? What's making all this problem? What do we do? Is it greed from Western countries? Or is it droughts caused by global warming? Or is it corruption in the countries we work in? What is it? Because you want to work out the root problem. That's essential, right? You don't want to just, you know, do the surface care of the symptoms. It's a little bit like when you wake up and you see you've got a sore on your hand and you think, oh, okay, put a Band-Aid on. The next day it's gone, that's great. But if you've got some underlying blood condition that's causing these sores, putting Band-Aids on doesn't fix the problem. And it's a little bit like that with the issues of poverty in the world. We want to discover the root cause of poverty and not just treat the symptoms without the root problem. And so the Bible tells us that all stems back to one event in Genesis chapter 3. So feel free to flick along in your Bible if you'd like, but this is from Genesis 3:17, when God was speaking to Adam and Eve in the garden. And he said to Adam, "Because you listened to your wife's voice and ate from the tree about which I commanded you, do not eat from it, the ground is cursed because of you. You will eat from it by means of painful labor all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. You will eat bread by the sweat of your brow until you return to the ground, since you were taken from it, for you are dust and you will return to dust." And so that was the very first event, where we see sin and that rebellion against God be the root cause of all the troubles that were to come. A root cause which makes this ripple effect, which we still see today in so many different ways. And the world becomes no longer that beautiful Eden, you know, the Garden of Eden, which was just so special, that relationship with Adam and Eve together with God in a beautiful world. The land becomes cursed because of their sin. It becomes increasingly difficult to work the land. Getting the food and nourishment that we need from the ground, it becomes a daily struggle. I mean, for us, we just go to Coles, but for the majority of the world, it's a huge struggle to be able to do that. And it's not just the land that suffers, is it? It's those relationships, Adam and Eve and God. Adam doesn't trust Eve. Eve doesn't trust God. Adam, they cover up their nakedness from one another. And most importantly, that relationship they have with their Heavenly Father is broken. And we see the ongoing ripple effects ever since then. We see that the Israelites, God's chosen people, called to be His, to live a life of love toward their neighbour and to one another. In Amos chapter 2, it says, "The Lord says, I will not relent from punishing Israel, His own people, for three crimes, even four, because they sell a righteous person for silver and a needy person for a pair of sandals. They trample the heads of the poor on the dust of the ground and block the path of the needy." And so even in the early days, God's people themselves treating the poor terribly, selling them for a pair of sandals, trying to make money off the vulnerable. And so that's the sort of world we live in, right? We're a sinful people We live in a broken world, a selfish world. Romans 3 says, both Jews and Gentiles are all under sin, that there is no one righteous, not even one. There's no one who understands. There's no one who seeks God. All have turned away and all alike have become useless. There's no one who does good, not even one. Not even one. And so whether you're rich or you're poor, whether you're Australian or you're Filipino or Tanzanian, you're a man, woman, or you're a child, each one of us, the Bible tells us, has this core problem, this core disease that needs to be dealt with before we can address the symptoms. Ignoring our humanity's core problem is like trying to fix skin cancer with a packet of Band-Aids. Our sin needs to be dealt with first. So what is the answer? What is the answer? What hope is there? Well, Jesus had a remedy, and Sam's reading for us from Luke chapter 5 points toward that together. So let's have a look how Jesus handled the disease, this core problem of sin. So if you've got your Bibles there, Luke 5, 17. And so the paralyzed man's brought to the house by his mates, a good bunch of fellas, and they bring him there to be healed. And they can't get into the house because Jesus is such an incredible teacher. Those of you, some of you might have been watching The Chosen. It's an awesome, I find a really great account of some of these things. And all these people are piled in listening to Jesus. There's no room in the house. And then the friends think, and I'd love to know this, love to meet the guy who decides, I've got an idea. Why don't we go up on the roof and tear a hole in the roof of this guy's house and then drop our friend down in front of Jesus. And that's what they do. And I don't imagine I'd want to be the guy, the paralyzed man, being dropped down for the first time, no practice, on the ropes in front of friend. But that's what happens. And he ends up lying there in front of Jesus. And everybody's watching. Everybody's watching Jesus, this great healer, expecting him to do something amazing. And when Jesus, verse 20, it says, when Jesus saw their faith, he said, friend, your sins are forgiven. I reckon that must have been like the biggest letdown for the friends who are up on the roof looking down, and this poor paralyzed man. He's thinking, well, that's not exactly what I came here for. I came to walk again. But Jesus says, no, your sins are forgiven, because Jesus sees deeper than even an MRI, right? He knows this man's greatest need, this core problem. And so he says, the Pharisees are listening, the teachers of the law, they're all listening, and they're thinking, this is ridiculous. Only God can forgive sins. And Jesus knows they're thinking that, and he says, why are you thinking these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say your sins are forgiven or to say get up and walk? I'd go with saying your sins are forgiven, because who could prove that, right? You're like, well, your sins are forgiven, that's good. And everyone's like, I don't know. But Jesus says, but that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralyzed man, I tell you, get up, take your mat and go home. And immediately he did it. He got up, got his mat under his arm, walked out the door. Everyone's gobsmacked. Unbelievable. Jesus has shown his power as the Son of God to be able to heal people in an instant, but also to forgive sins. And he's proven that he can forgive sins by doing what only God can do, by healing in an instant. And so this forgiveness of sins is what we all need, right? That's what every person since Adam and Eve has needed, is to be made right with God, have our sins forgiven. And Jesus is the answer to that. And we see that he goes on to provide that hope for us and that ability to be forgiven on the cross, when he died on the cross for us, took that punishment that we deserve, and made it possible for us to be his children and be forgiven. We are sinful people living in a world devastated by sin. We need to be forgiven by God and brought back into relationship with him. And that's what Jesus did. The sin is the problem and the cross is the solution. Jesus is the solution. And God's word challenges us, each of us, I think, to ask the question, have I come to Jesus to have my core problem, my core disease fixed and made right? Have you come to Jesus for forgiveness of sins? It's so important that we don't lose sight of our greatest need and the greatest need of the kids that we serve and our neighbours. Because when we know that root problem, that's going to change how we, or shape how we respond. And that's why the gospel is the first priority for compassion. As I was sharing before about how my friend Kristen said that's what he loved, is that compassion's Christ-centered. That's why we're Christ-centered, because that's what all kids and their parents and families and neighbours need, is to know Jesus. I wanted to put up a photo here of Noel. He was the country director of Philippines, amazing guy. And if you haven't heard much about compassion, you want to know who's doing the work on the ground. Well, he's one of the country directors, and this is what he says about our role as compassion and his role. He said, "My focus is on giving every sponsored child the chance to be a disciple in the way of our Saviour. This, I believe, is what makes compassion stand out. Not only do we give children hope, we also give them the chance to find eternal hope in Jesus." And that's what we want, right? That's what we want for our kids here in Sydney. That's what the kids are out there learning about now, is the hope of Jesus. But that's what we want for our sponsored kids that we care for too, because that's their greatest need. So should we then be focused mainly then just on sharing Jesus, on evangelism, and leave everything else as like other priority down the list and what have you? Caring for others, maybe level 2, 3, 4, 5, or even give that to other people who like doing that sort of thing. That's a good question. But Proverbs 14 says to us, it shows how what God wants us to do in response when we find people in need. It says, "He who oppresses the poor shows contempt for their maker, but whoever's kind to the needy honors God." And this is, I've been reading through Proverbs recently, and the amount of times that God talks about how important it is to him, how we care for the poor and needy, how we respond to them is incredible. And in this verse, he's saying, we're either showing contempt for God, the maker of these poor people, or we're honoring God, depending on how we respond to the poor and needy. And that heart for the poor and needy has always been a trademark of the people of God when they're living out their faith in the way that is right and pleasing. The Apostle Paul in Galatians, he had a meeting with the early church leaders, and they were talking about taking the good news of Jesus out to the Gentiles, the non-Jews. And he says in Galatians chapter 2, "When James, Cephas, and John, recognized as pillars, acknowledged the grace that had been given to me, they gave the right hand of fellowship to me and Barnabas, agreeing that we should go to the Gentiles and they go to the circumcised, to the Jews. They asked only that we would remember the poor, which I made every effort to do." So this is Paul, the gospel guy, the church planting guy. He's like all about Jesus, making Jesus' name known. But the other thing that they said hand in hand with that is care for the poor. And Paul said, I was eager to do that. And as they went, that's what they did. As they planted churches, that's what they did. And that's what we do, right? That's what we, when we read the Bible, we believe that good works and evangelism go together. That's just part of being a Christian, being a follower of Jesus. And Jesus is the ultimate example of that, that Jesus, who came to reconcile us with our Creator, didn't stop him over and over and over and over and over again, caring for the poor, the weak, and the marginalized in society. That God has a passion and a heart toward the weakest members of our society. And as his children, we must find some way of responding like that too, having that same sort of care. And we were told before, just in Proverbs, that when we care for the poor and needy, we honor God. How cool is that? We bring honor to God as we do that. Well, how did Jesus love? Well, we've seen that in his interactions with the poor and needy over and over again. But Jesus showed ultimately in that example that where the Good Samaritan, where Jesus told the story of this Jewish man who'd had been down this dodgy path, got the life beaten out of him by this gang of thugs. He's lying there, bleeding, dying. Along comes a fellow Jewish priest and ignores him. He's disregarded by this Levite who comes past. And he's completely without hope. And the question is, what does it mean to love your neighbor? Well, Jesus answered that by describing a bloke who came along and did something about it. He got down off his donkey. He cared for this man with... cleaned his wounds, put him on the donkey, took him to the inn, stayed the night at the inn with him, caring for him. The next day, said to the innkeeper, here's some money, please look after him, I'll come back and then I'll pay for any extra that needs doing as well. Because this man was able to show his love by his actions. Caring for people's material, economic needs is all part of being able to do that, isn't it? It's not an optional thing for Jesus, it's just part of how we love others. Jesus said love means being sacrificially involved with the vulnerable. And Jesus refused to limit that, not only how we love, but also who we love in that parable, because he's saying, regardless of their race or their religion or their background or their class or what have you, anyone at need is our neighbor. Not everyone's our brother and sister in Christ, but everyone is our neighbor, and we're called to love our neighbor. But before we can be that sort of generous believer that Jesus calls us to, we have to receive that first from him. We're like that guy lying on the side of the road, completely vulnerable, needing the mercy and the goodness of God. And only once when we've been saved graciously by God, then we can go out to be the neighbors he calls us to be that radical, loving Christians that Jesus wants us to be. Well, how should we love then? How do we put into practice everything that we've seen today? How do we respond? Well, through Jesus, God has rescued us. He's called us to be his people. And then what's important to God must be important to us, right? And so if you're a follower of Jesus and a child of God, then your life will be clearly marked by a heart for the poor and needy. If you're a follower of Jesus, you will give practical, loving care for the poor and help bring them the gospel of Christ, their greatest need as well. I've got to know a lady called Teresa. She's married to Jeremy. They're friends of mine. They live at Westmead. And she was sponsored as a compassion child in the Philippines as well. And she was sharing with me about what it was like growing up in her family. So she lived in a slum community, desperately poor family, very, very difficult situation. Her parents were activists. They were out all day long. She wouldn't see them in the morning before she woke up. They'd come back at night after she was in bed. Her dad hated Christians. He would be persecuting the Christians. He made fun of them all the time. He let Teresa go to the Compassion Program, which was run in the local church, because he thought that's going to help her get an education and what have you, but he hated the fact that there was any connection of church in his family. And then one day, one of Teresa's neighbours, they had a kitchen fire and set fire to their house, and it actually burnt down the whole community because they're so tied together. So 500 families' houses all burnt down in one day. And the first people to come and care for Teresa's family were the Christians. They were the ones to turn up, even though Teresa's dad had been giving them rubbish for years and making life really difficult. And that mercy really stood out to him. And so Teresa started being cared for at the church. She was able to live there with a whole bunch of other kids on site at the church. And one day her dad came to church to visit Teresa. He accidentally turned up on Sunday, and I sat at the back of church and heard John 3:16, that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son so that whoever might believe in him might have eternal life. And the next week he came back again and then again and again, and he actually gave his life to Christ. He became a follower of Jesus himself. And it was that two-pronged approach that he shares is why he became a Christian. He was loved and cared for by Christians, even though he hated them. And he also heard the good news of Jesus through the local believers. And so that heart for the poor and that sharing the hope that we have in Christ was an amazing combination for him. And now he actually runs the compassion program in the local church. He cares for 300 children and helps them come to know Jesus as well. Amazing turnaround in his life. And that needs to be our heart too, doesn't it? Have a heart for the poor and for the lost and for the needy, the suffering, and a desire to love them and care for them and bring them the good news of Jesus too. So I'm going to pray that God will do that miracle in our lives, that that will be our heart for others, and give thanks for what he has done for us in Christ. So let's pray. Lord, we do praise you and thank you for what you've done for us through Jesus. We thank you that you didn't leave us in our sin and in our brokenness. Lord, you sent your son to fix that root problem we had, which was separation from you because of our sin. Lord, we thank you for your incredible love and generosity and kindness and goodness to us. And Lord, we thank you as well for your heart for those who are poor and needy and struggling in our world. Lord, we pray that we will have that same heart that you do, that your spirit will move in us and shape us and mold us to be more and more like Jesus and want to be part of the solution, which is bringing the hope of Christ and the love of Christ to these people in need. And we just pray, Lord, it will be all for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
We've heard this morning that we've been called to love sacrificially, to care for others in the same way that Jesus has loved us sacrificially. We are going to sing about that now, so please stand. Had sung to him, now they cry for murder. Such a frail and lonely man, holding up the heavy cross, see him walking in Jerusalem. Save us. See him there upon the hill, hear the scorn and laughter, silent as a
contain him. Once the servant of the world, now in victory reigning. Lift your voices to the one who is seated on the throne.
Father God, your son's name is powerful. We are so thankful for him. We are so thankful that he forgives sins. We are so thankful that he brings salvation. We are so thankful that he gives us a wonderful demonstration of how to care for those in need. Father God, we pray in our hearts, in our minds, that yes, your gospel, your message is important. The truth is important. But without loving action, it means nothing. Father God, help us to be people that want to put your truth into action in our lives, but also into the lives of other people that we know. May that be our friend, our family member, or may that be the less fortunate one in our community, whoever that may be. Help us. In your son's name we pray. Amen. Our friends, take a seat if you haven't already. We have some announcements coming up. And the first one is obviously we're a church that wants to give to the work of the Lord. Give to the work of the Lord here in Marsden Park and beyond. And so if you do that already, that is absolutely fantastic. And if you want to join in generously giving to God's work, well, you can go to that URL and it gives you all the information. If you're a person that worships by giving in cash, there is a letterbox over there on the welcome desk where you can do that as well. What's coming up in our church? Well, there is a ladies' pancake breakfast. Woohoo! I'm not a lady, but I like pancakes. Who else likes pancakes? I don't know. Well, friends, on Saturday the 21st of September at 8:45, you are going to go and have some wonderful pancakes at Christine's place. And so if you want to find out some more information about that, well, obviously you can go to our events page, but you can also talk to Christine, who is in Kids Church at the moment, but she'll be around for morning tea. So that should be a wonderful thing to the ladies in our house, a pancake breakfast. I hope you enjoy it. And if there's any leftover pancakes, well, you know who can help you out there. What else is happening? Synod in the Greenfields is happening next Saturday. And there's a few people in our church who have volunteered in certain things. If you still want to volunteer, there's still an opportunity. And what we're really looking for is more volunteers to cover that sort of lunchtime period, so it's 12 noon to 2:30, and then pack up, which is 2:30 to 5 p.m. So if you have some spare time next Saturday, you can go to marsdenpark.churchgreenfields and all the information's there in terms of what you can volunteer for. Lastly, if you're new to our church or newish to our church, on the 20th October, we have our Life Together time. And that's an opportunity to come over to our house, so the Collinses, and enjoy a meal and also, I guess, have an opportunity to ask questions about our church, those questions that you may not have answered. So you're very much welcome to come and join us on the 20th of October. It'll be a wonderful time together. Our friends, if you want to connect with us, prayer points, anything that you need to communicate us, you can use the Connect cards. You can see the URL there. And there's always physical copies there on the welcome desks, which you can use. Friends, it's been a wonderful time hearing about the work of compassion. And my hope is that after the service that you'll go up and look at that desk and see the need of children around the world. Or maybe ask Paul more questions about it. Please don't leave today without going to that desk. And the good thing is you don't have to walk all the way up the back for morning tea. Morning tea is located right there today, right near the compassion table. So you can get a tea or a coffee and then turn around and talk to Paul. So that would be wonderful. Friends, please collect your children. And as you might be aware, the bathrooms are over there in Block C. And I'm going to pray before we finish up. Father God, we just want to thank you again. Thank you for the work of compassion. Thank you that so many children around the world are brought out of poverty through what compassion is doing. But we know that even in countries like the Philippines where compassion is active, there are still so many more children that need the support that maybe members in this church can give. Father God, we just thank you that you give us resources in Australia and you give us a generous heart where we can use those resources to help others and also to glorify your son Jesus, not just here in Australia, but also around the world. Father God, thank you so much. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.